given to you, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Good morning. And welcome to our service today, the first Sunday in the season of Advent. I keep turning to this, although it's not operating anymore. We're starting to use the second Sunday. We're using this new sound system, and I apologize for some that I didn't turn it off during the hymns last week, so I'll try to remember to do that. And so I'm still experimenting with this, so I do need your feedback. I did get one positive feedback last week from John Kamba, who said that it was the first time he'd ever heard my sermon. It must be doing something well. That's good. There's an awful lot of announcements today. I'll try to go through them very quickly. First of all, I want to thank everyone, and I know there were a lot of you who helped with the tea and the bazaar yesterday, which I understand was a big success. Anybody who was there can attest to that. And there are many events coming up. There's somebody attesting. And they're in the bulletin. Please take the time to read all of the announcements. So many of them are important. There is a blue Christmas service for those for whom Christmas is not simply a time of joy and celebration for whatever reason, some kind of loss usually in their life. That's going to be held in the chapel on Sunday, December 17th at 4 o'clock p.m. And everyone is invited to that service. It's a very moving service. And I know that Kathy Dayton, where's Kathy, has an announcement that, announcement about the PNC.
Yes, good morning. The pastor nominating committee is in the process of being formulated by the nominations committee. Our plumb line committee submitted the report to Presbytery, and that's poised to be approved this coming week. The nominations committee will be meeting Monday, and we are actively seeking members. We need 7 to 9 members of our congregation to serve on our pastor nominating committee. We are looking for people to represent all factions of the church, young, old, trustees, music, deacons, I'm not leaving anyone out late, of women's committees. We want everybody's input, so please, if you know somebody who would like to participate, please reach out to a nominations committee member and speak to us. Again, we will start the process tomorrow night, and we look forward to hearing from each and every one of you that would like to be part of this most important process for our congregation to move forward. Thank you.
Okay, and I will encourage you and remind you, you may nominate yourself. You can volunteer by your name to that committee, some member of the committee, Kathy is the chair of it, or another person in the church. If you know someone who you feel would be a good member of that pastor nominating committee, speak with them, but also give their name to the nominating committee. There are several announcements in here that people have asked me to say something about. I'll try to do it quickly. The adoptive family, which was started last Sunday, is a very important part of this church's Christmas Advent ministry. And there are still some names that have not been taken. So if you have not yet had a chance to take an adoptive family card or name, please do so. Deborah Buskey will be available after worship in the coffee hour, and you can take those names. Also, there are tickets for a raffle that are available, will be available where Lynn Jones usually has her table. She'll also be selling tickets for the cocktail party and tickets for the raffle. There's so many important things in here. Is there anything I've left out? Anybody have any other announcements? Yes.
The DW pledges $5,000 a year to the church budget. And due to the hard work of Christine Haddad and all the elders who gave of their time, their donations, and their purchases yesterday, DW raised over $3,100.
I didn't know the figure, but that's amazing. That's great. And there is still stuff available in the fellowship hall after worship today. You can still buy things. Also, I want to announce that there's today's communion, so we won't be having Sunday school. The pre-K and kindergartners, after the children's sermon, will go to the nursery, but all the other children will remain in worship today. Have I forgotten anything else? Yeah. Sign up for the Santa brunch. Where is that? At Lynn's table. Okay, sign up for the Santa brunch. I knew I was forgetting something. Anything else? If not, what there is? Yes.
Hi, I'm here to talk to Walt Baker, who might be doing some baking this year. We'll have the event on the 17th in the hall, and call me when you're super lit, 288-1688. I'm in the phone book, old-fashioned phone. Let me know if you can do anything, or would like to, or if you bread, cookies, whatever. Thank you.
That's for what?
Santa brunch.
Oh, for the Santa brunch. Okay, so you cruise and lift. If you can help with the Santa brunch. Okay. No, no. Yes, Jean, oh yes.
Adult class of 11-16, anyone is invited, everyone is invited, but we won't be in the regular classroom. We will be in one of the other classrooms.
Right, then the first one in the hall, on the left. Off the elevator call. Yes, in other words, Jean's class will be today after worship. Anybody else? That's another hand? Okay. Maybe we can finally get on with worship. Let us worship God.
Oh,
the Advent wreath, which is printed in the bulletin. The litany for it is the call to worship.
Some large, some small, many
before ourselves and each other and God. Let us pray. God,
our all-time and agents, our earthly leaders in the body, and we are caught under air, we are at end. We are still recovering from Thanksgiving, for the latest crisis, for the long list of things to do. The demands of our times seem unending, the tasks seem overwhelming, and our energy is draining. Holy God, speak to us in the stillness of this moment. Speak to us in the depths of our hearts. Let there be a space for you in the midst of all the hurry and rush. A holy inner place that cherishes silence and alone, that keeps a candle lit and a pen being ready. Create in us a place for the river. Amen.
And now hear the words of assurance as they come to us from Jesus Christ. Your sins are forgiven, totally eradicated, eliminated, forgotten. In the past, they are over and done. Everything has become fresh and new. Friends, in Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. Any kind of a tree that's decorated this time of year is a Christmas tree, yes?
I
It's a pine tree. Yes, it is a pine tree. It's an evergreen, isn't it? Which means what? I don't know. It's not really, but it's a mess. It is a real tree, just a plastic one. So anyway, what is special about an evergreen tree? How is it different, say, from an oak tree? The leaves stay green all year long, don't they? They don't fall off in the autumn, like other trees. And what's different about the way this tree is decorated? You notice anything different than the one in your house or some of the one on the stage? All the decorations are paper. They look like paper, but they're actually... No, well, they could be paper. Some of them are paper, and some of them are... They're different materials. But what else is different about them? Oh, they all have signs that we learn in church. Yes, very good. What else?
All the ornaments
relate to church. Yeah, they don't relate to other things, to Disney and things like that. These are all Christian symbols. This is called a Christmas tree. Can you all say that? Christmas. Sounds a little like Christmas, but it's Christmas. It's the word Christ. And then a shortened form of monogram. And does anybody know what a monogram is? It's a big word. This is a monogram. You ever see anything like that anywhere? Yeah. Where do you see them? Where do you see something like this?
Right there.
Right there. That's right. Where else? A big letter in the beginning of the chapter of a book, yeah? In my hand, yeah? What about on shirts? You ever see people with monograms, their initials? These are the initials of somebody, aren't they? It could be Isabel Carol Burnett. Okay? ICB. In other words, a monogram is just a symbol, usually the initials of a person, that represents that person. And these are monograms. These are symbols of Christ. That's why they're called Christ monograms or Christmas. Some of them are different ways. Some of the crosses are upside down, but that's still a cross symbolizing Jesus. All of them are symbols, monograms of Christ, of Jesus. And there are ways that the church has over the years remembered who Jesus was at first. Now this is, you may not know this, but for many years after Jesus was crucified and died and resurrected, the church was not able to celebrate being Christian. People were not able to celebrate being Christian openly. They had to do it secretly because it was against the law to be a Christian in the early days. And so people would use monograms, symbols of Christ that other people, authorities, police and stuff, wouldn't know. And they'd wear them on their clothing. And that way other people would know they're a Christian. Because otherwise they couldn't talk about it openly. So this tradition goes way, way back of using symbols to remind us that we are followers of Jesus Christ. And this is one way we prepare for Jesus coming at Christmas time. Can we go back over and have a prayer? Okay, we'll stand up again. Stay up. Come and sit down. And let's hold hands and join in prayer. Okay, just hold somebody. Okay. Lord, we thank you for these children and for all the ways that you are preparing them for a life with you through Christ. And this Advent season, help us all to help ourselves and our church and our children and our families prepare for your coming. And we pray in Jesus' name, taught us to pray together.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Okay. The pre-K and K go to the nursery. Everybody else stays here with your families. Thank you. scripture gathering today is from the Gospel of Mark, and it will be this coming year. And today's lesson is from the 13th chapter, which is toward the end of the Gospel, verses 24 to 37. But in those days after that suffering, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. Then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near, at the very gates. Truly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my word will not pass away. But about that day or hour, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. Beware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey when he leaves home and puts his slaves in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on the watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening, or at midnight, or at cockcrow, or at dawn, or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all, keep awake. This is the word of the Lord. Well, today's text deals with the coming of the end of time as we know it, the time of final judgment. A minister once wondered how the media would handle the end of the world, and he put together a few possible headlines. USA Today, we're dead. Wall Street Journal, Dow Jones plummets as the world ends. National Enquirer, Brad Pitt and Jennifer Aniston together again. Inc. Magazine, 10 ways you can profit from the apocalypse. Rolling Stone, The Grateful Dead reunion. Sports Illustrated, game over. Playboy, Girls of the Apocalypse. Ladies Home Journal, lose 10 pounds by Judgment Day with our new Armageddon Guide. TV Guide, Death and Damnation, Nielsen ratings soar. Well, the season of Advent is about the coming of the Lord as a babe in the manger in Bethlehem. But also, it's about the coming of the Lord as judge in power and might, when everything that we know in this world is over and done, and we are eternally with God. Most of Advent, we tend to focus on which one of these. You know it, don't you? The first coming of Christ, the birth of the infant Jesus to Mary and Joseph. However, on this first week of Advent, the focus in the scriptures, certainly, is traditionally known as the second coming of Christ, the end of the world. People have interpreted what Jesus said about this in different ways. Some understand it to mean that God created this universe for a relatively short period of time, and that before too long, it will all come to an end. Because of this mentality, certain individuals stand on street corners with signs warning that the end is near. And also because of this same mentality, scientists have tried to figure out scientifically when the universe began and when it is scheduled to come to an end. Personally, I think that these are the wrong questions to be asking. because I don't think God created this universe with a big bang 4 billion years ago or 400 billion years ago. And I don't think this universe will come to an end next Tuesday or next year or 10 years or in 10 trillion years. As for our little planet and even our sun, they will one day come to an end, I imagine. But in terms of our capacity to understand time, the universe has been here forever. And even though it was indeed created by God, and I believe that it will be here forever, because I believe God will never stop creating human beings to share his love and joy and life with. But I'm more interested in what Jesus was trying to get us to think about when he spoke of our need to be prepared for a time that will come and will come suddenly, like a thief in the night. One way to think about this is to think about our own death. For when and how, or even if, the universe will end is not certain. However, it is certain that there will come a time when you and I will be in the realm of eternity and not here in the realm of time. So the question this season, the challenge of Advent is this: are we ready? Are you ready to meet God? Are you ready to stand before the judgment seat? Rather than thinking of when the time will come or what it will look like, I'd like for us to think about what it means for us to be ready for it when it comes. I'll briefly mention just 4 qualities of life that I believe make up what it means to be ready. First, to live with the assurance that I am a child of God, that you are a child of God, that if you die today, you would know for sure, without a trace of doubt, that you will be with Jesus Christ. This readiness is a confidence, an assurance, an awareness that God is gracious and that I am a child of God, that God truly knows my first, my middle, and my last name, that my salvation does not rest on my good behavior, on my good theology, or my denominational pedigree, only upon the assurance that I know for sure that I am a child of God, loved by God forever. Think of the thief on the cross next to Jesus. Jesus said to him, "Today you will be with me in paradise." For that man whose life was certainly no better than yours or mine, there was a certainty that he was loved by God and was given the assurance by Jesus Christ himself. You are that thief on the cross. I am that thief on the cross next to Jesus. And Jesus himself offers you and me the assurance that God's eternal love and life everlasting will be ours. Do you believe it when Jesus looks at you, no matter how many times you've strayed from yourself and from God, and says, "Today, you will be with me in paradise"? This Advent season, stay awake and prepared in this way. Know with all your heart that you are a child of God and that Jesus Christ is with you and will be right there with you forever. A second quality of readiness is to be a person of love. To be a person of love with your nearest and dearest, your husband or wife, your sons and daughters, your mother, your father, your closest friends, strangers, and others in need. If you're going to die tomorrow, why would you want to have a fight with your spouse today? If you're going to die tomorrow, Why would you want to neglect your child today? To live as if I'm going to meet God face to face tomorrow is not only to avoid doing negative things, but it's also to do positive things. I not only avoid having a fight with my spouse, but I do something nice for her. Isn't it a pleasure to do something wonderful, tender, and nice for your spouse, your parents, your children, and even that person with whom you have a conflict? This Advent season, stay awake and prepare in this way. Be a person of love. The third quality of this readiness is to do the job. Just do the job. To do the task that God has assigned you. Do you ever think about all the roles God has given you in this life? Personally, to do and to be? It can be overwhelming. There are so many. I, for example, am called by God to be a husband, a father, a grandfather, a great-grandfather, a brother, an uncle, a cousin, a pastor, a friend, a neighbor, a citizen, a member of the human race and caretaker of this planet, and many more roles that I haven't even mentioned. To live with a sense of readiness is to be my many roles, to serve the stations that God, of life that God has assigned to me, to do them diligently and faithfully, to do them in such a way that God, as my parent, will be proud of me. And when God sees me tomorrow, face to face, will say, good job, well done, good and faithful servant. The fourth quality of this readiness is to be loyal to the values of Jesus Christ, to be loyal to the sense of love, justice, and compassion, to always have a special concern and commitment to the poor. In the book of Romans, Paul says, knowing that the time is coming near, don't do what the world is doing. There is to be no drunkenness, no sexual immorality, no fighting, no hatred, no greed, no jealousy. Don't do these things. For the time is indeed coming and will be here soon when you will find yourself with God and with Jesus Christ, and you will not want to be embarrassed at the values that you live for and by. You want Christ to be proud of you. This Advent season, stay awake and prepare in this way. Be loyal to the values of Jesus Christ. Suddenly, that's how life happens, doesn't it? And Jesus said to people of all ages, be ready. Be prepared. His advice as he spoke to us just before his arrest was to live today as if you were going to meet God face to face tomorrow. That's what Advent is all about. And yes, he is in us and we are in him. We are well off in God the Almighty, in God's holiness always. Amen.
He's in rehab.
But he's home, but he's in rehab.
Okay. Thank you. Yes.
Built that story in our prayer list. He's a co-worker of mine, and I just found out he's actually in John Hopkins now in clinical trial. He has colon cancer, and they have failed in Cleveland, but they have to be talked over. And I just like to ask for a
question. Joe, that's for you. Okay, thank you, Brian. Yes. Child of kindness. Her name is what?
Jacqueline.
Okay, thank you, Richard. Are there others? Let us pray. Lord of light, of truth, of love, of power, and of justice, hear us as we lift our hearts to you this day. This is a season of the year and it is both very easy and very difficult to be a faithful Christian. So we come to you and ask for your help. As we wait for the coming of your Son, Jesus Christ, at Christmas, we also prepare for the time when we are with him in paradise. Help us, Lord, to live out each and every day that you give us on this earth as gracefully and as compassionately and as sensitively as we can, being ever mindful of those around us and their needs, as well as of how we can make each day brighter and better for those in need. Help us this Advent season to be able to enjoy the parties, the shopping, the giving and receiving of gifts without forgetting the very purpose of the season. We thank you for all who helped with the Christmas tea and bazaar yesterday, as well as those who came and participated in it. We pray for our church and its ministry and for its upcoming search for an installed pastor. Let us also remain aware of the world we live in, with all the ways it is rapidly changing. We pray that your Holy Spirit would continue to surround us and support us as we seek to make this world a better place, especially for those who suffer. And we pray for all those whose names have just now been lifted up to you, for those who are on our prayer list, and for those who are in our hearts and in our minds. And finally, we pray for ourselves. You know what we need, O Lord, far better than we ourselves. We open ourselves to your Holy Spirit and look with humility and gratitude for the way you are right now seeking to provide us with exactly what we need the most, whatever that might be. All this and much more we pray in the name of your Son, our Lord, Jesus Christ. Amen. It's now time for our sacrament of Holy Communion. I invite you to join with me in the invitation to the Lord's table. seated. Now let us join in the invitation to the Lord's faithful presence in the vault. This is a joyful feast to the people of God. And from east and west, the peace of the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to our God. Let us pray. Dear Lord, our Heavenly Father, you who have given us so much for such a long time, we thank you for all the ways that you have over and over and over again sought to help us on our journey through this life by coming to us through prophets of old, through the covenant, through the law, through all the ways years and years ago that you have revealed yourself and your love and your desire for us, to us. We thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, through whom we have more than any other single way an ability to know who you are, who we are, and how we are to relate to one another through love. We thank you for all that he said and did. We thank you for those who wrote down the things that he said and did so that we have a record of them. We thank you especially for the sacrament of communion, which he instituted, whether he understood exactly how it would be used or not at the time when he met together with his disciples at the Last Supper that he would share with them on this earth. It was the Passover meal. And at the beginning, he took the bread, and he blessed, and he broke it. And he gave thanks for it, and he shared it with his disciples. And he said, "This is my body, broken for you. Eat this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, at the end of the supper, he took the cup, and he poured it out, giving thanks to God for it, blessing it, and sharing it with his closest friends. He said, "This is the cup sealed in my blood. Drink from it, all of you." Lord, we pray that this bread and this cup will be for us the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Thank you. O Lord, enable us through the word of Jesus Christ to be your free obedient servants in humility, gratitude, compassion, and joy. Amen. Thank you for this sacrament. which reminds us that you flow through our veins, through every cell and molecule of our bodies and our spirits. Amen. Now please join with me in the unison communion prayer printed in the book. Let us pray. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I invite Kathy to come up for the permission.
We will be in the parish halls for the next 3 weeks after worship. Hefford International has projects all over the world that empower impoverished families through gifts of livestock and training, a valuable resource that allows families to improve their nutrition and income to build a better life. Your continued support to Hefford's cornerstone principle of passing on the gifts multiplies as each family passes on their gifts of their animals for first offspring to another family in their community. Please help us see that one person, one family, one congregation to make a difference in today's world. Give a gift that keeps on giving. Let us give our gifts.
Thank you.
dear Lord, we know that you have made everything in this world. You have been so generous to us every day. We pray that this church will show our generosity in giving back to you what is already.
Why don't we sing just the first verse of the last hymn, Hark the Herald Angels Sing. Keep you.